Many scientists are here, and they will undoubtedly talk about the planetary boundaries. Do we know how far we already pushed the planet? Do we know how far we can still push the planet before systems start to collapse? It has been always a theme in environmental science ever since the 1972 Stockholm Conference. But what we also see is a new theme coming up, namely that of how to govern this planet. There was a long period in which we thought that we knew how to do that. There needed to be a world government, a United Nations organization that organized global problems with global politics. But now you see slipping in some uncertainty whether that format still will work. Has the United Nations enough power to actually provide solutions? Does it have enough legitimacy? So what you see shifting in the world of scientists and academics is a shift from the bioscience towards the governing science, the science of governance. Okay, so just a brief report on what we heard so far. I think what was really interesting is to look at the global change in terms of years. And you see quite an interesting thing occurring around 1950. Then suddenly all these emissions and all the usage of fertilizer and of fossil fuels really go up very steeply. And Diane Liverman today presented this evidence in a very compelling and concise way, suggesting that there is indeed something significant, that the welfare state that we know and that we associate with the post-war years was really also funded by the exploitation of nature in a very unsustainable way. Now, the good thing is that here are also scientists that have been telling this for a long time, but now also say, hey, but some things are moving, some things are actually changing. So for instance, fertility is going down. So although we know we might move to a world of 9 billion, that might be the upper limit that we are going to experience. It's not as if this is always just a runaway world. It's also a world where things move in different directions, showing us options of alternatives. Similarly, there are countries where deforestation is slowly making way for reforestation. And interestingly, you always are confronted with the fact that even though some things are nice in one country, that's often to the detriment of things occurring in other countries. So while Vietnam is doing well in protecting its own forests, probably it's Laos that's paying the price for that. Now, the highlight for me actually today, and if you see behind me, this is all my colleagues walking around from session to session and gathering and exchanging thoughts. It was actually the talk by Tony Giddens, who I will speak to later, who very persuasively argued for what he called a realist utopianism, the idea that you now have to look yourself into the eye as a world community and try and do something very different. So that's the talk that I think is powerful, the idea that we have a systemic problem, a problem that our system is just not functioning well. Now, and that seems to be a talk, a way of looking at the problematic. That's also important for Rio, that we should change the practices that express what is normal. So perhaps green accountancy rules, a green business sheet, thinking about fair practice. Now sometimes it will be governments that have to come up with these ideas, but it can also be that it's consumers, citizens, that just call for it and governments follow these citizens.
We will call for an absolute commitment to inclusive green growth as the only way forward. We will argue for GDP plus, by which I mean the measurement of our natural and social capital.
I'm now on my way back from the big Planet Under Pressure conference in London. A major conference, and also one that showed how difficult it is
for scientists to position themselves vis-a-vis politics. So if you wanted to have a round of applause in the 3,000 seat theater, it were scientists saying things like the world must, or this is the limit, or this is the boundary. And as a scientist, actually, you should be really uncomfortable with that role, because it's for us to give the best knowledge, but it's obviously for politics to decide what must be done. Nevertheless, it was a useful conference. I thought there was a bit too much talk about the world as if the world has a cockpit. So if we talk about planetary boundaries that we shouldn't go beyond, there was always an allusion to some mysterious center of politics that would then have to act differently. But our world in the 21st century is not like that. You might love the UN, but it's very clear from recent environmental history that the UN is not able to produce these sort of results on its own. In the conference, I think there emerged a consensus that we're looking towards a mode of governance which we call polycentric governance. The Nobel Prize winner Eleanor Ostrom promotes that notion since a couple of years. And it is much more that you think how to coordinate between different governments and society to reach goals, rather than that there is some mysterious center that or speaks out what has to be done. Now, how to make that work, I suppose, is crucial. And personally, I think that what is important is that we get a sort of a storyline, a narrative on what the 21st century goals should be. And I was touched by what we saw also about the need to combine planetary limits with social needs of people. It's not as if we just want to stay within planetary boundaries after all. We've got people at the bottom of the society which have direct hunger and don't know how to get their most basic needs. And there's a lot to be said, I suppose, for prioritizing the needs of those. Driving through these congested streets of London is actually a good moment to reflect on the difficulty in reaching good results when it comes to global environmental politics. I mean, here we are at streets where the average speed of the traffic is still the same and in the period of horse and carriage. We've never been able to speed it up. Despite all the roads we built, it's still at about 12 miles an hour maximum. Now, this conference shows that the academic community knows a great deal about the challenges facing the planet. But also there was a cry from the natural scientist for more understanding of what good governance is. They do realize more and more that it is about implementable solutions that people can relate to, that governments are able actually to execute, rather than just putting to politics the set of measures that must be taken in order for the planet to survive. Now, that challenge, I think, is very much now on the table, and I'm looking forward to meeting other experts of governance that can help think about what sort of modes of governance can help achieve the global environmental results.